All right, let's start. Good afternoon, everybody. On behalf of the Center for Chinese Studies here at the University of Hawaii at Manoa, I would like to welcome everyone to our Spring 2023 CCS webinar series. And today's session featured as an interregional faculty dialogue on the presentation, Counter-Occupying Americanism in South Korea and Taiwan, Taking Back the Spaces of US Space Cultures in Cold War Musical Number, by Dr. Evelyn Shi from the Department of Asian Languages and Civilizations at the University of Colorado Boulder, who will be in conversation with two esteemed colleagues of mine from the EAL department here at UH Manoa, namely Dr. David Kolikowski and Dr. Andre Haig. My name is Ming Bao Yu, and I'm currently serving as the CCS director. My home department is East Asian Languages and Literatures at UH Manoa, where I teach 20th century Chinese literature, film, and culture. As the organizer of this year's webinar series, I would like to acknowledge the kind assistance of the CCS Executive Committee and CCS Associate Director, Ren Yomei, Dr. Cindy Ning. Please note that today's session is being recorded and the file will be uploaded to our CCS YouTube channel, where you will also find previously recorded CCS webinar sessions. Our full program flyer for this semester can be found on the CCS website and Instagram, and you can see the links to all three media platforms now in the chat forum. Today's session is kindly co-sponsored by the Department of East Asian Languages and Literature and the Dane Lee Funds for East Asian Literatures, as well as the Center for Korean Studies, both here at UH Manoa. Many thanks to all of our co-sponsors, and particularly EAL talk series organizer, Dr. Pia Tomasi and Dr. David Kolikowski for the kind assistance. Before I introduce our three speakers today, allow me to quickly go over some procedure reminders. Feel free to use the chat form for posting technical or other queries, but use the Q&A tool for posting comments or questions to our speakers, which will be answered during the Q&A session. We kindly ask that you please keep your comments concise and ask no more than two questions so that we can accommodate everyone and keep within the 30 minutes we have allocated to the Q&A session. We will try to take questions in the order they have been submitted, but we might also synthesize or group together questions that are similar so that we save time and make room for other comments and queries. We further reserve the right to dismiss comments and questions that are not relevant or civil in tone. After today's session, you will receive a brief survey, and we would greatly appreciate your constructive feedback. And now it gives me great pleasure to introduce our three panelists today. Our invited guest speaker, Dr. Evelyn Shi, is a scholar of Sinophone and Korean literature, media, and cultures, who frequently works in a comparative mode. She is currently an assistant professor of Chinese at the University of Colorado Boulder. Her work has been published in the Journal of Chinese Cinemas, Modern Chinese Literature and Culture, and the Journal of Korean Studies, as well as various anthologies. Additionally, she is the co-editor of a forthcoming special issue of the Journal of Chinese Cinemas focusing on noise in Chinese media. Dr. David Kolikowski is an assistant professor of Korean literature in the EAL department here at UH Manoa, who received his PhD degree from the University of Chicago. He specializes in modern Korean poetry, colonial literature, and translation studies. And his prolific scholarship has appeared in notable journals like Japanese Language and Literature, Azalea Journal of Korean Literature and Culture, the Routledge Companion of Korean Literature, as well as in the Korean language journals Hyundai, Sihak, and Sima. Dr. Kolikowski's noteworthy translations of Korean literature have appeared in well-known publications such as The Margin and the Chicago Review. Dr. Andre Haig is an assistant professor of Japanese literature and culture in the EAL department at UH Manoa. He received his PhD in Japanese literature from Stanford University and taught at the University of New Mexico from 2013 to 16. Dr. Hicks' research interests include Japanese imperial literature and culture, Zainichi Korean literature in Japanese, and the problematic of ethno-racial passing. Specifically, his work and long list of publications explore how the insecurities and terrors attendant to Japan's annexation of Korea and internalization of the Korea problem were inscribed within the literature, culture, and vocabularies that circulated within the Japanese imperial metropole. His forthcoming edited volume entitled Passing, Posing, and Persuasion, Cultural Production and Coloniality in Japan's East Asia Empire will be published this year by the University of Hawaii Press. Dr. Shi will speak for 25 to 30 minutes, and then we will first invite Dr. David Kwolikowski, followed by Dr. Andre Hake, to each speak for 10 to 15 minutes and respond to Dr. Shi's questions. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming our three speakers, and let me now turn over to Dr. Shi.
Thank you so much, Bingbao, Dr. Yu. And also I wanted to thank Cindy, who is there kind of overseeing our session. Let me start the share so that I can show you my PowerPoint. And very happy to be with everybody here today. Looking forward to comments from David and Andre. Thank you for reading my work ahead of time for that. Okay, so here we go. So my paper today, or my talk today, is about a phenomenon that I noticed in my study of Taiwanese and Korean cinema, and has perhaps implications for other Asian cinemas in countries that have had American-based culture. I'm focusing specifically on the cinematic representation of entertainment spaces catering to Americans, spaces that evoke in the film audience a pair of twin sentiments, that is, Americanism and anti-Americanism. So we're solidly in this, you know, 1950s to maybe early 80s era. Although, you know, to acknowledge there are still many US bases in the Asia Pacific today. So first, Americanism, what am I talking about there? To be very simple, to give a definition, it's an orientation of desire towards what is perceived to be an American style of music. I will be focusing specifically on music, although it can also pertain to other cultural products during this time period. So this Americanism may be expressed as a cover of an American song in English or in translation, or as an original song in that style. Right? So here is an example. Actually, it doesn't have any lyrics, the sequence I'm about to play, but you can see how the style of music is being used and set against a montage to really suggest the attraction of this kind of Americanist space. And also it helps the viewers of the film to arrive in this environment. Now, as a caveat, I've been told that this music is actually more British invasion than American pop. But actually, what I do want to point out is that this music was popular specifically in spaces associated with American consumption in both Taiwan and Korea. And if we think about how popular the Beatles were in America, I guess it makes sense, right? A lot of British music did use the American gateway into the Asia Pacific. So this is from a film in 1969, Dangerous Youth, directed by Xin Qi. So I think you get the picture. There's a, you know, twirling neon lights of the Shanghai Hotel, the Hoover, with English language signs. There's canted angles, body parts of gyrating in this dance floor. So this is the kind of Americanist space in cinema that we find a lot during this time, right? Especially in youth films. Now, the opposing position to Americanism is, of course, anti-Americanism, which is a sentiment against American occupation, empire, and culture. It's specifically linked to the post-war presence of US soldiers in Taiwan and South Korea, as well as its guidance of foreign policy. And of course, as I mentioned before, it's a broader US-based network. So it probably applies to many other countries as well, but that's what I'm focusing on today, right? So I think it bears noting, actually, that in Taiwan and Korea, openly expressing anti-Americanism could be a little bit dangerous, actually. It could get you detained or worse, because the regimes in power in Taiwan and South Korea were so dependent upon US aid during this time, and also the US security umbrella, right? So the governments officially had nothing against the US, even when there were some conflicts on the ground. And it was a slippery slope from open anti-Americanism to being accused of, for example, communist sympathies. And to be fair, the leftist intellectuals in both countries did admire the courage of the PRC and the DPRK in countering American imperialism. But what I want to talk about today is not so much a leftist analysis as so much as a simpler response. That is, when I say counter-occupying Americanism, what I'm talking about is a reclamation of these public spaces taken up by American bases and American people, and in some cases staking a claim in the autonomy of local music, showing it to be cosmopolitan and not simply dependent upon outside styles. So hence my title, it's a counter-occupation not of territory, but of the utopian promise of entertainment in urban space. I'm relying a lot on cinema today, but cinema did not act alone in creating these forms of entertainment and in reclaiming these spaces. In fact, many of my examples today will show cinema is integrated into a whole media environment, industrially, aesthetically, and experimentally. So there was integration very clearly with the record industry, which would put out records of these songs alongside the film. It was great promotion for both sides. There were, and in the filmic representation itself, you see a lot of radio, television, nightclub theater. And so it's represented in the film itself. You'll see that these other media, right? So I also want to talk about my particular strategy here in discussing the musical number rather than the full genre of the musical, which can be a little bit more controversial. In Taiwanese and Korean cinemas, the musical number of this era is highly portable, or even you might call it modular, right? Because it shows up in many different guises, sometimes in films that are really very far from the archetypal Hollywood musical. And what I mean by that is in analyses of the Hollywood musical, scholars will talk about things such as integration and dual focus. That is to say, there's integration between the musical number and then the narrative that's beyond it. You don't just get a song out of nowhere. It's somehow integrated into it. And also, structurally, there's often a dual focus. So there's an A and a B that have to be integrated by the end, most often figured as a couple. So if we think of West Side Story, for example, you have the woman from a Puerto Rican community and the man from the American sort of gang group, and then that they are the dual focus, and they kind of become integrated as the narrative goes along. And of course, many of the movies with musical numbers that I'm looking at don't follow these patterns, right? And instead of trying to measure them against this, I look at other ways that musical numbers are used. That is to say, sometimes they're pop star vehicle films where you just have a lot of the pop songs of a particular star being used. You have songstress films in the Chinese film tradition. Sometimes the songs are dropped in place of a voiceover to show the inner thoughts of a character. May not be performed by that actor themselves, but it's playing that function. And then finally, there can be a single showstopper or nightclub number. It happens quite a lot in this era where they just want to give the audience that feeling of being in a nightclub, right? So musical numbers can happen for many other reasons other than to complete a musical, in short. And I think it's a good idea to recognize the difference here. So a case in point, Let's Meet at Walker Hill, a Korean film from 1966. It's a film that has so many musical numbers, I lost count, but it doesn't quite fit into the archetype of a Hollywood musical because you see the protagonist here, Mira, Namira, she is very important in the story, but there are also so many, like a barrage of musical numbers by performers that are not even named in the film itself, right? So they don't have anything to do with her narrative. They're just shown performing in this film to provide this variety to the viewer, right? It's depicting, in short, a whole musical scene and performance scene of the time. Now, a little bit more about this character. Nam-mira is a classic orphan figure. She lost touch with her father during the Korean War as a young child, and then more recently lost touch with her lover in the city of Pohang, which is a provincial southeastern city in Korea. After wandering to Seoul, after being discovered by a famous composer and musical producer, she's a rising star on the musical scene. So then we find later on that her father and her lover that she's lost touch with were both played by comedians. Both arrive in Seoul at the beginning of the film, and they don't know that they're searching for the same girl, but they are helping each other to try to locate the missing loved one. So they go through a wild goose chase through all the performance venues where they hear Nam-mira may be performing, from the smaller clubs to the radio station to the TV station to an American club where all the menus are in English and they don't know what's happening because they're from the countryside. And then finally they get back to the stage, backstage of the Walker Hill Hotel dinner hall, where they are finally united. And what you see here is an image from that dinner hall in Walker Hill. So then Walker Hill is shown as a sort of pinnacle of the system. And after Walker Hill, Mira's musical producer says she should be headed for Southeast Asia to play as an international star on that circuit. So what we see in Let's Meet at Walker Hill is actually a reflection of a broader phenomenon. And that is what I call the American base culture in Korea, right? The ABC. And we can start talking about this by thinking about the camp town entertainment and performance halls that are around the base camps, right? And so it wasn't just something that sort of sprung up organically and was fueled by the local people. In fact, the US Army itself took a very strong hand in centralizing and controlling who got to perform there. So an office called the US Seoul Area Command Special Services Entertainment Booking Office actually booked all of the performances for over 200 clubs around the various bases in Korea during that time. So then the Korean acts would come in and audition, and they were rated on their proximity to American performance style. So this is actually very different from Taiwan in that they actually were rewarded. They would be paid more even if they were considered to be doing a more perfect mimesis, right, of those exact song styles, performance styles, accents, and that sort of thing. And then, so finally, I want to make a quick note that the Walker Hill Hotel itself was opened in 1963, and it's named after General Walton Walker, who I believe perished during the Korean War, right? So all of these spaces were kind of linked together through booking and through their association with American clientele. Now, just to give you a sense of exactly how perfect the mimesis is, I'm just going to play a short clip from the film Let's Meet at Walker Hill, and you'll just listen very carefully for what he's singing and how.
South of the border, down Mexico way, that's where I fell in love when the stars above you came out to play.
Right, so here, south of the border is Mexico. Definitely, you know, not going down past Jeju Island to Okinawa or something like that. Kind of geographically, the song has been kind of transplanted fully into the Korean context here, right? So we get the idea. I hope we can get that feeling of the American pop music of late 50s to 60s from this sound. So the lesson that I want to take away from what I've said so far is that we see this network of performance spaces that allows for rising aspirants to move up a global ladder, right? So we see this reflected in the film itself. Now, the situation, as I mentioned, is a little bit different in Taiwan. It was far less centralized and much more based around actually rest and recreation of American soldiers, particularly during the Vietnam War period. Right. So the flyer that you see on the right side is actually what was handed out to soldiers as they arrived in Taipei for their, their rest and recreation period. There were a lot of what were called American troops clubs, Meijun俱乐部, and Western style restaurants, Xitanting, that came out around this time in Taiwan. And what you see them performing is actually kind of a new type of variety show built on this, around this clientele. There were things like magic performances, you know, fire swallowing, clowning, and of course, different styles of music, right? And there was a burst of this activity during the escalation of the Vietnam War, as I mentioned. And following that, as the government tried to protect local performers more and prevent people like foreigners, like Filipino musicians from coming in to fill those spots, local musicians started to fill in these clubs and bars. And then you saw the emergence of what was then called vernacular or hit music, 热门音乐, in those spaces. And it was heavily associated with Mandarin language translation or Mandarin speakers. It would be the primary clientele. So this is just a depiction from later on, Edward Yang's famous film, A Brighter Summer Day from 1991. There's a scene where within a Mandarin speaking community, there are these kids who are singing an Elvis song, right, at an ice cream parlor. So you see that this 热门音乐, this hit music is starting to have circulation during that time. Now, I've been emphasizing the Mandarin speaking community because what I want to point out, and this is not discussed as much in the scholarship, is actually that there's an intersection of Americanist music with Taiyu, or the Taiwanese Hokkien culture. And for this purpose, I'm drawing many of the films in this talk from the corpus of Taiyu Pian, or Taiwanese Hokkien films. Very quickly, for the uninitiated, these are films that maintain a separate audience from the Mandarin film industry, which were called National Language Cinema, or 国语片, by the government of Taiwan. And the Republic of China officially endorsed only Mandarin as a national language, even though there were other languages going on in post-colonial Taiwan. So what I'd like to argue now is that the Taiyu culture in Taiwan actually had its own vision of Americanism and anti-Americanism during this period. And for the first example, this film, May 13th, Night of Sorrow from 1965. So what you'll see is the protagonist that pictured here, Shu Hui and her sister Shu Qing, were orphaned at a young age. And Shu Hui has taken up singing at an American style bar as one of her many odd jobs. And she's quite good at it. She's a star. All right, so what you can see here is that she's singing the Paul Anka song, Crazy Love, in a sort of self-orientalizing kind of set that's happening here. So this Paul Anka song is from 1958. You can see this absorption of the song and sung in English into the Taipian idioms. And also it's interesting that, you know, what she experiences in this environment is actually the pressure to do sex work, right? There's a wealthy businessman at the club who's pressuring her to have a private meeting, and her boss is kind of behind it, right? So she needs to escape, and she finds a young man as her champion who's also at the bar. She kind of runs out with him. And what I want you to see here, the dialogue doesn't really matter, is that they actually went on location and shot the actual area where a whole row of these American clubs and bars were, right? So you'll see the famous OK Bar and Susie Wong towards the beginning of this clip.
Ho ho, Annie ho. I
didn't
want to
lie.
Okay, so it's important to notice, you know, that they want you to be in that environment, to know that this is a space that she is in danger of being forced to perform sex work against her will, or actually assaulted. And it's compounded by the low social status and stigma that comes with a woman taking work in a dinner show in that context, right? So although the sexual exploitation is figured as something that is demanded by a local man and not an American soldier, the film makes it very clear that this American bar is a space of exploitation for women like her. Even while it can be, as we saw in the earlier clip, dangerous youth, it can be a space of entertainment and hedonistic pleasure for more wealthy young women and men alike. So this element of exploitation, I should say, is mostly absent from Let's Meet at Walker Hill. However, the Korean film actually more explicitly shows the presence of English in the dinner show space, such as at that one club where all the menus are in English. And they do also show identifiably white clients in the Walker Hill Theater, which the Taiwanese films don't really do, right? So they do acknowledge that there is a kind of uncomfortable racial balance that is happening in some of these spaces as well. Okay, so the reason that I feel we are compelled to think about these spaces in Taiwan and South Korea is linked is because they in fact belong to this broader US-based network. And in fact, their different locales were very aware of each other. For example, there are reports in Taiwan around this time about the high-tech stage mechanics and quality shows at Huake Shandrong, which is how they rendered Walker Hill, right? And there's a panic that, you know, we could never catch up with them or send an act of equal quality to Korea. Okay, so they did measure each other that way. And this performance circuit would include not just Korea and Taiwan, but also places like Thailand, Guam, Okinawa, and the Philippines. Maybe there are more that I'm missing. And you also see similar types of groups doing well, such as the Kim sisters, who became very famous in the US after getting on the Ed Sullivan show. You also had the Yuan sisters from Taiwan who you know, went to Okinawa and Japan and also many Southeast Asian bases, right? So what was represented in Let's Meet at Walker Hill really existed. So we can see that the lessons that we want to take away in our comparison as we move along is that the American bars and clubs are a space of both exploitative labor and hedonistic liberation. And this, I think, is true of the Korean case as well, although it's not as much represented. And then from the Korean film, we see there's a network of performance spaces that allow for rising aspirants to move up a global ladder. And this is not as present in the Taiwanese films, but it is also true, right, in reality of that sort of performance ecology there. So as I move towards finishing up my talk, I'm gonna compare a couple of films along the lines of how they actually do stage this counter-occupation of Americanism, right? How do they stage that inversion of the marginalization of local music and then the exploitation of local performers in the informally occupied spaces of the bar and performance hall? So I'm finally going to show this clip. And what you see here is this climactic performance at Walker Hill by Namira. And so I want everyone to kind of like look at the sets and then how it draws us in and creates this intimacy between the viewer and the performer here.
사랑한 가슴 속에 낙엽만 쌓이는데 못 잊어보고 싶은 마음 괴로워 흩어진 추억에 눈물만 흐르네
Right, so what we see here is a counter-occupation, I would argue, of the American style. Erased are the American military consumer and the perfected English. We're all in Korean now. It's in the lyrical mode. And what comes to the foreground is the eyeline match, especially towards the end here, of the performer with her two most intimate male connections, right? So we get closer and closer to the performer, and then we have this eyeline match with these very clear objects of her affection, which are her father and her future husband. And the longing expressed in the lyrics here has a very clear subject and object. And if we're not convinced yet that this space is Korean, we also see the letters ROK clearly emblazoned upon the monumental rockets in the background of the set, claiming the Walker Hill for the nation, right? So this performance is now only for these two men and not for the mixed company in the whole dinner hall. So moving on, I'm going to introduce a Taiwanese film called Zhang Di Seeks A Zhu. This film, like Let's Meet at Walker Hill, explicitly names an actual American style club. In this case, it's called the Hong Kong Club. You can see it's all in English letters and has that kind of, you know, vaguely orientalist lettering. And it evokes, you know, the glamour of Hong Kong, right? But it is in Taiwan. Now, this is where Zhang Di, the actor, was actually known to take the stage in his life outside of the film. But you'll see him, and within the film, what he plays is actually a poor country boy who's stuck in a janitorial job and also as a waiter when he enters the doors of the club, right? So he's no longer a performer in the story of the film. He is this laborer. And in this sequence, the character falls asleep and then dreams of occupying the stage aspirationally, performing a song very much in the style that Zhang Di, the singer in real life, would often perform in spaces like the Hong Kong Club. So I will note also that this is the only song in Mandarin that he sings in the entire film, and he sings many other songs in Taiwanese Hokkien. So we'll see that there's a stronger implication and association of American style in mandopop, even within the Taiyu Pian. So this is Zhang Di. So they'll keep going on, but I'll stop there with the clip. This song, as far as I can figure out, is not originally an English song, but a mandopop original that embeds the English words "I love you" as a refrain. The Americanist song idiom, as well as this Americanist club space, are now counter-occupied by the local man in the sequence, becoming the vehicle for his fantasy of social mobility. The woman dancing there with the short hair is also his love interest, who has disappeared, that she's the Azu that he's seeking. So it's a fantasy in more ways than one. But I would suggest in closing that the most potent counter-occupation is when the space of the Americanist performance actually disappears altogether, and all we hear is this really beautifully vernacularized style. For this, I'm going to introduce the final example of The Young Girl Goes to Town, 1966. In this film, the preteen Biying has left her provincial home in search of her missing father. She sees a group of medicine sellers in front of a temple performing to get some crowd interest in their wares. And this was something typically that medicine sellers would do in Taiwan in that time period. There's a man, there's a handsome man, there's a woman, there's a second man dressed as a clown, but they're just failing terribly because they're really bad performers. So being this young girl you see in the middle here, she gets on stage to help by singing a tune herself. And the song is called Wandering in the Lakes and Rivers, 流浪在江湖. I'm going to stop it there for the sake of time, but as you can probably sense, they have totally the wrong instruments for the music that you're hearing. But what you're actually hearing is something that would require a drum set and guitars and, you know, the typical sort of Americanist band setup, but they've just kind of dispersed with that. You're not in a dining, you're not in a nightclub, you're not in a bar. You don't need any invitation or entrance fee. Instead, it's restaged as a sort of temple performance using that open space, which is a traditional public space of gathering, right? Both sacred and secular, because sometimes you'll stage outdoor opera there, sometimes puppet theater, and it's for the benefit of the community. So they've taken this type of music and brought it outdoors and made it actually very accessible to local people. And you don't see any American male consumers at all, or rich businessmen, right? It's offered to the whole Thai, specifically Thai audience. And also very notable is that the Americanist musical style is really absorbed into the Thai idiom of wandering the lakes and rivers, which has multiple valences. The first is a world of martial arts, but during this time, it also had the valence of the world of itinerant medicine selling, and also the world of entertainment, right? So it defies the definition as Americanist, and it integrates things like kind of Inca style, Mando pop, even some Thai popular song type of idioms are going into this music. And it's this very exuberant vernacularization. So in this final disappearance of the Americanist entertainment space, I would say that the counter-occupation of American style is complete. As in Let's Meet at Walker's Hill, the music is ultimately the medium that brings separated families together, an intuitive mode of connection and communal solidarity working against the exclusion and exploitation implied by the American space. So that is the end of my talk, and I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shi, for this wonderful, you know, presentation and these very interesting clips. So at this point, we would like to ask our two respondents to respond each about maybe 15 minutes, and then maybe the three of you can engage in some kind of dialogue. At this point, I also like to remind our audiences to please post your questions through the Q&A. And please don't wait until the last, you know, post it now, even though we'll save the questions for the last 30 minutes, right? But if you wait, we may run out of time to answer them, okay? So with that, you know, Dr. David Kolikowski and then Dr. Andre Haig.
Well, I'm going to start by thanking you, Evelyn, for this really interesting presentation. You know, as always, I'm kind of astounded by, you know, the work that you do, and I don't think it's an exaggeration to say not many people can do this genuine comparison between, you know, looking at Korea and Taiwan in the way that you do, not only in this project, but in your other work as well. And so in this paper, you're looking at Korean and Taiwanese musicals from the 1960s under the umbrella of kind of international Cold War culture. And I would say that, you know, from my understanding of the paper and the presentation, you're really focusing on a kind of underlying tension between local and American culture, kind of what you pointed out in your presentation as kind of a pro and anti-American culture that are, you know, resting side by side in some of these cinematic depictions. And, you know, American culture is most vividly represented in these films and the music, what you know, standard pop, which from what I understand is a term that was used at the time to refer to American music, you know, by virtue of it being, you know, just called standard is in itself very telling. And I'm really interested in kind of, you know, this idea of counter occupation. You really focus on, you know, the surroundings of military bases and kind of the culture that sprouts up around them and how the films depict them as, you know, spaces of cultural mixture in a way. But also, as you point out, they're, you know, they function and, you know, the opportunities in clubs in these areas function simultaneously as opportunities for some local talent, but they're also spaces of exploitation. And so again, we see tension arise there. So I have three questions for you. Well, I have a few more, but I'll just start with three. And then if we have time later, I can ask more. But I want to start by kind of probing this idea of counter-occupation that you ended the presentation with, and maybe thinking a little bit about kind of the stakes of what counter-occupation entails or implies. And I want to frame my question in terms of the way that the films themselves deal with counter-occupation. In the two main examples that you showed at the end of the presentation, the scene with Zhang Ji, which I think you specify is a kind of dream sequence, right? Where we understand that he's daydreaming and it concludes with him waking up. And I thought that was very interesting framing of, you know, this moment in the film where he seems to counter-occupy, to use your terminology, kind of reclaim this space and this moment just for himself or for other locals like him. But it seems really significant that he wakes up and then is fired, right? From what I understand, after the scene, there seems to be some kind of commentary there and, you know, kind of the beauty and the poignancy of the moment seems really connected to our understanding as a viewer of the film that this is not real, that this is a fantasy for the character. And similarly, not having seen the latter film, The Young Girl Goes to Town, I was wondering how that film contextualizes the sequence that you described. Is it the film's conclusion? Is there also some sort of commentary there? But even if there is no commentary, I'm still, you know, it still is a film. And I'm wondering, you know, once the film is over, kind of the illusion dissipates and there might be some kind of, you know, the way that it's working, it's not just triumphant. And there's a kind of poignancy that this is not real, that it's only a cinematic representation. So I'm wondering how, what do you think about those layers of meaning? The second question is more of clarification, but I wanted to ask you about how you're using the term vernacularization in, you know, the paper. The way that I was kind of understanding it based on your explanations is it seems to be that you're referring to a kind of bottom-up localization of music, but I was wondering, maybe I'm understanding in a different way. And to quote from the paper that you circulated to myself and Andre, you say counter-occupation proceeded apace with the vernacularization of the music itself, and along with, you know, broadcast TV, radio promoted a localist music for localist demands by sidestepping the audience of Americans. So I'm just wondering about the term vernacularization. It's a thing that I talk about in my own research, but it means slightly different things. And then my third question, regarding some of the language or phrasing that you used in the paper. It's on page 9, but I'll read you back what you wrote. You argue that Americanist musical style and even the US military base circuit itself as something that rightfully belongs to the local audience. And I'm just curious in terms of thinking through that argument. I mean, I think I agree with what you're saying, but I just want to make sure or you know, think about maybe the implications of this. I can see how the US military base, you know, that space and, you know, thinking about territory and all those things, I can see how that rightfully belongs to the local audience. But I'm more curious about how, you know, thinking through specifically Americanist musical style, in what way does that rightfully belong to the local audience, especially since we're identifying it as being Americanist? What, how do we kind of work through what, you know, belongs and in terms of, it seems to be a kind of, you know, international style, even though we're kind of identifying it to be American. In what way do you see that as, do you see that the music or the style of music itself as belonging to local audiences in Korea and Taiwan? So I think I'll stop there, but I have more questions and I'll turn it over to Andre, and then we can talk about, you can address whatever you see fit.
Aloha. Oh, can you hear me? First, let me just say to Evelyn, that was fantastic. I love the longer paper and the chapter, but having you perform it with these clips from films that I hadn't seen and these musical performances, that added something, another dimension to it entirely. And the impact was very different. And now I have to find a way to see these films and appreciate this more. I want to thank Mingbao Yu for creating this this rare but important opportunity for inter-regional faculty dialogue. And on that note, as the relative outsider on this panel, coming out of Japanese studies, the imperial culture, I think I'll just you know, briefly offer a couple of comments and questions that you can hunt for in my rambling remarks that will set up the discussion. There's a lot to say here. So again, I very much enjoyed engaging with your new transnational comparative work on the Cold War musical in East Asia. I'm intrigued by these innovative visions of counter-occupying the Americanist performance space in Taiwanese and South Korean films, you know, visualizing that entertainment scene without the American occupiers. So most of this was very new to me and eye-opening. Admittedly, I know essentially nothing about the musical scene and the musical cinema in Cold War South Korea and Taiwan, or really even in Japan for that matter. And as the representative of Japanese studies, I think I'm contractually obligated to talk and ask about Japan, which might be annoying, and you don't expect to know anything, but it's about finding connections, right? So I was thinking, I would be hard pressed to name a Japanese film from this era that was really in dialogue with something like Let's Meet at Walker Hill, or you know, May 19th, Night of Sorrow, or Changi Seeks Achu. Even though, as you pick up on, Japan is also an important part of this U.S. military base circuit, you know, that you've so vividly sketched out for us. But I thought about it more, and I realized that thanks to your work, in the 1950s and 60s, there are examples from Japanese cinema, you know, of films that also don't neatly fit the definition of the classical, you know, musical genre, but did center musical performances of hybridized American-esque forms and styles, like, you know, jazz, pop, enka, in ways that also indicated this omnipresent cultural occupation or preoccupation. So almost just off the top of my head, I'm thinking, for example, of a film that I'm watching with our students in Manoa this week. It's Masumura Yasuzo's Coca-Cola comedy, Giants and Toys, from 1958, which features and culminates in this grotesque colonialist rendition of a nativized jazz performed in blackface. But there's also some Suzuki Seijun films like Tokyo Drifter, and perhaps even Kurahara Kuriyoshi's Black Sun. And actually, now that I saw these clips, I saw some of the stills, Let's Meet at Walker Hill, That club, that stage reminds me so much of some scenes from Tokyo Drifter, which I'm watching in my class next week with the students. Let me catch up, but I think these examples I'm thinking of are all very different from the musical films that you've been discussing here. As the U.S. maybe the military industrial entertainment complex is rarely visible, maybe with the exception of moments in some of Suzuki Seijin's anti-Americanist films. And there's little sense that the musical performances or styles were shaped by the tastes of American servicemen per se. So does this mean that's already been erased and disappeared? Or I wonder if these films capture a condition where the Americanist occupation is so pervasive and so deeply internalized that counter-occupation in terms of appropriation and transformation of forms, is always already there and taken for granted. As this character in the film Giants and Toys proclaims at one point, Japan is America and America is Japan, and you can't separate out the two. So coming out of this context, I did wonder about that, the potentially amorphous scope of the concept of America and Americanism, which could be so slippery, meaning so many different things, the military presence, cultural hegemony, Cold War capitalism, these class and regional based forms of exclusion, and this sexual liberation and exploitation. And you do explore, a number of these, and suggest, I think, that the productive tension around the signifier America and Americanism. So I'm satisfied with how you're using them, but in the Japanese context, it just seems like it's omnipresent but also elusive. Overall, I'm so impressed that you've uncovered this seems to be a really rich genre or subgenre of musical cinema in this new sense that links Taiwan and South Korea. And it's just wonderful to see someone highlighting these kind of transnational connections and networks. And I guess on this Taiwan-South Korea comparison, it's not surprising to find parallel currents running between locations that belong to the same U.S.-centered base entertainment network. I noted in the opening anecdote in your longer chapter, which I don't think you explored today, from Taipei's first hotel in 1966. There's a clear sense of this competition and rivalry between nodes on the network as they race to showcase their top talent for, I guess, first and foremost, American eyes and ears. But I also, back to Japan again, I wondered if there was some sort of hierarchy you see among the countries on the Asian, East Asian, U.S. military base circuit, and where the former imperial power Japan might fit in there as a node. And another related question I had is how might you account for some of the differences in tone, style, and critique between the Korean and Taiwanese films' visions of counter-occupation? Obviously, they're drawing on different local vernaculars and local styles. But just one more thing that I see in the background, maybe doesn't even need to be said, but another point the two countries have in common is that they're both former Japanese colonies. And we're all aware there's these often raised cliched observations about their divergent ways of processing the post-colonial legacies of Japanese occupation. And I don't need to rehash them here because I know you know, and I'm most familiar with your really fascinating trans-colonial comparative work on nonsense culture, pre-1945 Taiwan and South Korea, which I'll recommend to all who are here. So I'm tempted to ask if you're seeing or sensing or drawing on any continuities between these two projects, your larger intellectual project, is there a layering of post-colonial strata and strategies and desires beneath these cultural responses to a neo-imperial, neo-colonial occupation. For example, it seems like an all too neat way of framing the varying forces animating the visions of counter-occupation could be a nationalism in South Korea, which we see with the ROK rocket there, versus maybe nativism in Taiwan, and that's a schema which might reproduce or echo colonial era tropes, and I think that could be simplifying things. A post-colonial echoes could be found in the film's critique of local collaboration with these networks, which I think this was discussed more in the longer chapter that we have, where you discuss how there's some awareness or critique of how Korean and Taiwanese agents and business interests are involved in enacting exclusions and exploitations on behalf of American cultural overlords, and they're really essential to the operations of these entertainment networks. I mean, is there a way that the post-colonial might map onto the neo-colonial counter-occupation here, discourses of collaboration and complicity? And finally, and I have a lot more I could say, but and this is maybe just a throwaway fun comment, but the highly standardized Korean system of producing top talent to entertain the American occupiers, which you discuss, it brought to mind the very systematized production of K-pop talent today, and the South Korean global soft power machine overall, which emerges decades later. So just for fun, are we seeing how the stirrings of the Hallyu boom are born out of the U.S. military entertainment circuit, or maybe the aspirational energies of counter-occupation in reaction to it? Maybe some have already looked at this topic. It went through your footnotes, I sense that, but it's just a fascinating question to me. Let me close here, although I can elaborate on any more of this, and I hope we can discuss more. I just want to thank you for sharing this exciting new work with us, and you can pick and choose and respond to what you find interesting or helpful in any of these comments or not. I'm sure we'll have a vibrant discussion and a lot of questions from the audience. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much to both David and Andre. Should I take some time to answer now? I think that's what's next, right? Okay. I'll just go for it as we wait for some more questions. I'll start with answering David. Thank you so much. You give me a lot of credit, but I'll do what I can to answer the questions. I think what you're saying with the first question is, what happens after the counter-occupation, right? Because, even if we're not talking about a dream sequence, it does dissipate after the film is done, right? And so this is maybe where I need to get a little bit more into where I'm drawing an idea for why this might be useful, which is Richard Dyer's entertainment as utopia, right? So in that article, it's like kind of a classic art, maybe like from the 80s or something like that. He talks about how the form of the musical is not sort of, openly just, being critical and trying to lay out, for example, how things should be in the future. But if you really read into its structures and the sort of non-verbal things that it's showing you, that you can really see it has a utopian sort of spirit to it, and that's what we are sort of drawn to when we're watching it, actually, right? And so in my sort of more long-term work, I actually study comedy, because I do think that something like comedy or the musical, through means that are maybe not conscious to the people who are consuming it and watching it, can begin to feed that part of your sort of ideological and political orientation that can't be openly voiced, right? And in this case, as I mentioned, if you were openly anti-Americanist, something like the Korean short story "The Land of Excrement," right, Punji, where it's like openly anti-American and like almost violent, very violently so, I should say, then you might face a sort of you know, what's it called, an obscenity trial, right? Called obscenity, but really just because it's politically incorrect. But on the other hand, when you have these sort of fleeting counter occupations, what you see is kind of like a cultural form that many different people can consume without feeling endangered, right? And through that, it kind of gathers a form of unofficial public opinion. And that's what kind of moves the society slowly, slowly forward. And it's not really as immediate as, you know, it's a call to rise up for a demonstration against the Americans. But it's something that sort of slowly changes public affect and public opinion. Just and a quick answer, in The Young Girl Goes to Town, there isn't really as much of a commentary. It's just like something that happens in the film on the way. So yes. The next question about vernacularization, I think what I'm trying to talk about is this idea of not being purely mimetic, right? So it's not being measured, in short, against the standard that both David and Andre are talking about. It's not like how close you can get to an American song that will mark how good the song is or give it its value, right? It has other aesthetic values that people are buying into, actually. So the first step towards this is to have, you know, local people performing the music, right? So first they have a sort of passion for it. They're sort of drawn to something about it and they're performing it. And because they're performing it and they also have other musical experiences and also other human experiences, there are other elements that are going to come into the new music that they then put together, right? And so it also becomes an issue of the music going out of those particular performance spaces, which are perhaps more standardized, more monitored, more sort of held to those standards, and into other types of recording and performance contexts where it's important to appeal to different audiences, right? So that then it becomes a very sort of rich, you could call it vernacularization, you could call it a hybridization, but I think it's kind of just an organic sort of growing of something into something beyond the original model, right? And I think that actually leads very well into my answer for the third question, which is, in what ways does the musical style belong to them? And so I think you're right, I maybe could have articulated this better in the written text itself, but I think I'm consciously using the phrase Americanist because you can only have Americanism outside of America, right? So it points to a position of desire or, you know, a sort of facing towards that can only happen if you're not in America, right? Or if you are not that, right? So it's not that the music is American, because once, you know, it is out of that context, it begins to not be so American anymore, right? I think even servicemen who are listening to the music outside of America, it's a different experience than listening to it at your, you know, local bar in Wyoming or what have you, right? So it's going to be, I think, a recontextualization through the social spaces that it's now taking up a position within. And because, you know, originally it was only for servicemen, but then you start to have a lot of local audiences, either through privilege or just because the doors start to be more porous, you get more local audiences also consuming the music, which, and I am a firm believer in that, the audience also begins to push forward, you know, what the music will become, right? So the musicians don't kind of produce the music in a vacuum. They also need to play to it. And then, you know, and this is gonna answer in part to Andre, which is, you know, Japan is an interesting place to perform your music if you're from Korea or Taiwan during this time. I'm not sure, I think, I have a hunch, I don't think it was as popular for Korean performers. It wasn't like as much of a sign of prestige to crow about to perform in Japan, but for Taiwanese performers, it was actually a point of pride to be able to perform in Japan during this time, that you're good enough to perform in Japan. And because of the different audience, right? So it wasn't always the Americanist songs that were most popular. There was also this sort of, the sort of chinoiserie that was performed in a sort of self-orientalizing way by Taiwanese performers who then went to the Japanese circuit. So it was playing to both the Japanese audience and the American-based audience in a way. So you'll see, like, you know, the girls are dressed in those, like, what are they called in English? The cheongsam, you know, like that, like a very sort of like supposedly traditional looking, but really more like mid-century effect Chinese outfits, and then performing these songs that are supposed to evoke a sort of timeless Chineseness. You'll see more of that happening in addition to singing a couple of songs in English, right, or translated into Mandarin or Chinese or Taiwanese, right? So I do think the audience is very important, and it kind of creates these new opportunities as well as you move around the circuit. So thank you, David. And then to move kind of more fully on to try and answer some of Andre's questions. So first of all, thank you for giving me a film list to go check out now. So I basically a little bit ran out of time to check these out, even though I knew that it must exist, right? So these filmic representations must exist. And The Giants and Toys sounds like I should really take a look at that, because it's kind of related to some of my interests from the colonial period. That is to say, I have a sense that there are a couple of different things with Japan and Americanism or anti-Americanism, right? So the first thing is that I know, I've recently been looking into the colonial era engagement with jazz music and what that meant. Of course, there are some books on the subject, but I do think that the idea of jazz and like that era of Americanism is a very important precursor in Japan for the music, right? And also Enka itself absorbing so many different styles into kind of prior styles of Japanese music. I think there's an early era of this sort of mixing and excitement in the 20s and 30s that should probably be looked at with that. But in terms of just the post-war era and the sort of rock and roll and then the pop songs of that era of America that are there, you know, doo-wop, you know, that sort of thing becoming popular, I think that, right, you might actually see, I don't know if it's in musicals, but definitely in youth films, or as you say, like the Suzuki Seijin type of thing, you'll see that kind of Americanist reference as well, right? So there's an interesting relationship between the cinematic styles that happens during that era. So I was also thinking, yeah. I don't have like a good answer for what it looks like in there, but I do know that, you know, some things did go through the region. For example, there was a sort of mambo music craze. And you also, I don't know if anybody picked up on this, but Mexico comes up as a theme in some of the clips that I showed. There was the man who was kind of dressed in a sombrero and a sort of floofy shirt. So I think a lot of that was kind of absorbed, you know, at the same time through some of the same circuits, probably related to rises of Mexican cinema and its presence and interaction with American cinema and music scene. And of course, you know, Cuban music and mambo and everything like that, right? So a lot of other things actually also made their way in, which makes this period very interesting to talk about. In terms of anti-Americanism in Japan, I would say it has a kind of different lineage. This is as far as I know, right? Because I know about, there was a huge kind of sort of social fervent around Anpo, right? So renewing the security between the US and Japan, that it was a kind of like very open and trenchant, and you know, like there was a big social battle about this after, you know, and after the sort of 60s fervor died down, then Japanese politics gets much more boring, for lack of a better word. But during that time, it was kind of very open in a way that I feel like would not have been permitted actually in South Korea or Taiwan. And so a lot of that was, as I'm trying to talk about, sublimated into these entertainment genres, perhaps, when they weren't getting, you know, writers locked up in obscenity trials. Okay, so then the next question was very interesting to me. So is there a sort of difference in critique of the American occupation in the materials that I presented and found this time? It does seem that the Taiwanese films were a little bit more critical, but I also suspect this has to do with the fact that the Taiyupian were less regulated than the Mandarin films by the state in Taiwan. Whereas this was sort of like all kind of the same language in Korea and sort of centrally monitored during this time. And so there may have been a little bit more freedom actually to be more openly critical in that way. Because if you watch Walker Hill, then you realize it seems like everything is so positive, you know, like in general, except for these small moments where you're like, oh, what is happening here? Like, who are we making fun of? So I do think maybe it's possible it's because of my samples that I'm finding a little bit more of the critique there. I will say that in terms of post-colonial critique, it does seem like, you know, I think what you're alluding to is that the narrative in Taiwan is generally more positive towards Japan and more connected to Japan in this period than in Korea. However, I think that kind of local Taiwanese intellectuals and writers were also very kind of critical of this post-colonial, like over-friendliness in the 60s and 70s. And so they were very kind of aware of that, as were, I think, Korean intellectuals during that time, when the normalization of relations was kind of put forth and then signed in 1965, right? There was kind of like uprisings about, you know, how can we do this, right? So I think that there is an internal critique about local collaboration, in short, happening in both of these places. And then similarly with the American occupation, although I will say that the sense of occupation is probably more serious in South Korea, because there are more and more consistent bases, right? And so it was kind of a short period of time for Taiwan, and it kind of ebbed and flowed depending on how much the US wanted to send troops through Taiwan. But it seems like a stronger type of kind of long-term association in Korea. So there is a sort of difference just because of US policies. And then lastly, right, we could say, yeah, I mean, I've definitely heard the comparison of Kim sisters and as a sort of like early form of K-pop, but I think you are right that there is a standardization that's happening in K-pop that, you know, maybe for more corporate reasons is echoing what was happening in the earlier era, which is more of just, you know, like a standardization for the purposes of American consumption, right? In this case, I wouldn't say it's purely for American consumption, although it's definitely working for that nowadays. Yeah. Okay, so I'm gonna stop there and see if we have any questions.
Actually, okay, thank you very much for your comments and question. We actually have an anonymous attendee just posted a question. Okay, which I will read. Thank you for the talk and the discussion. May I ask a layperson question beyond the political and occupation agenda? Is it inevitable that Americans at the base needed to create a culture of familiarity, perhaps similar to Chinatowns in the US, from the perspective of the locals and not through the lens of film producers? Were they counter-occupying or showing their ways of welcoming a foreign genre of music by fusing their localness into foreign genre and singing I love you in the local song. This question is motivated by the assumption that such counter-occupation can be seen as cultures of Taiwan and Korea being flexible and accommodating and open to foreignness. Okay. So would you like to answer that question?
Sure, I can go. I can answer that first. So first of all, I would thank you for the question, Anonymous. I would probably say that it is different from Chinatowns in the US in that the people living in these bases are not immigrating there, but they're kind of staying within, you know, if they're living at the base, they do come out of the base, but they're kind of there temporarily is the idea, as actors for, you know, the American military and the American nation, right? So that's something different from what people who live in a Chinatown are kind of expecting. They're not really sort of organized in that way and moving to the US under those auspices. And I would say in terms of, are they welcoming a foreign genre of music? I would say, you know, I don't know how we would know if they're, oh, the question disappeared. Oh, there we go. There we go.
It's actually in the chat. It's actually also in the chat form. You can see it. I just put it in the chat form. Okay.
Okay. Thank you so much. So are they welcoming the foreign music? I mean, you could say that they're welcoming the foreign music, but I don't know if they're welcoming it for the foreigners, right? So it could be because it's a fresh style. It's associated with the, you know, the young people, in a way that, you know, could we say that, you know, older generations are welcoming or not welcoming to TikTok? You know, it's just like a new thing that the young people are sort of like adopting it more quickly than the older people, because it's interesting, it's new from what your parents were in touch with, right? So it could be that. It could be because American songs also have a certain cachet along with American culture. In terms of after 1965 in particular, there were more people trying to study abroad and to gain that sort of, what should we call it, cultural and social capital by being associated with Western things. So you could say that there is an openness to this kind of foreignness in this period, even though there is also a critique of it.
I actually had a follow-up or related question to that. I mean, when these songs that are for you examples of counter-occupying Americanism, when they were performed in these American base club, what was the reception actually from the American soldiers? You know, presumably these clubs were only open to Americans, right? What was the reaction? I mean, when the norm is to perform these songs in a sort of American style, right? And then you suddenly have these performers bringing in sort of the local flavor, local style. I think one of the clips you showed us, the song was performed in one of these clubs, right? But was it the one where the singer had eye contact with her husband and the son? I don't know if it was, but I was wondering, what was the reaction from the majority of the, if you have data on that, right, of American servicemen? Because it was suddenly something that was foreign to them, okay? And also, I mean, who controlled the program, right, of these clubs? Was the musical director, were they Americans? And was there a clear directive that the songs had to be tailored, had to be American style because they were performed for American soldiers who felt homesick and wanted to hear maybe these kind of songs? So I think a little bit of follow-up on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. I mean, I'm sure it kind of depends on the venue. And how closely it had links to the booking office, right, in terms of, you know, what the particular set list would look like. But one thing I didn't really get into in the talk actually was that, you know, in Korea as well, there would be, you know, what is called their trot music, which is kind of Enka-like, you know, so local types of music that would also be performed. And I would say that it's kind of received in the same way that I was talking about sort of chinoiserie being accepted in Japan, right? So it was a sort of, probably the performers didn't think of themselves as being self-orientalizing by doing so, but I think that it could be appreciated as a sort of exotic local color that is added to the roster of mostly Americanist performances, right? Because in the film, Let's Meet at Walker Hill, you do see some performances by noted trot performers, right? So it is part of, it shows you actually it's part of the lineup, even though most of it is about, you know, Americanist pop songs and sometimes sort of big musical sequences or even kind of modern dance, you know, that sort of thing. So I would say there is room for accepting the foreignness as an extra value added, right? For the American, actual American servicemen audience as well. Yeah.
Okay, so we have another question that I'm putting in the chat so you can also see that. This is from my colleague Yun Peng from our department. Is there a similarity between American bays and Jianghu, river and lake, in terms of their being a deterritorialized space, at once real and imaginary? You have mentioned mimesis and mimicry a couple of times. Does mimicry feature as a counter-occupying strategy?
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Yun. That is a very interesting set of questions. I had never thought about American bases and Jianghu being together before, so that's very interesting to me. I mean, I would probably say that you probably couldn't say American bases are entirely imaginary, right? Because they really do have ramifications for American power and for the presence of armed people who have a different sort of extraterritorial right from the locals. And, you know, it's not sort of, see, I always pictured Jianghu as being sort of like a Wild West type of space in that it's not ruled. It doesn't have, the attraction of it is that there's no authority present there. There's no sort of centralized government authority. And so I find it hard to kind of put them together, but it's kind of amusing to me to think about the American base as also being somewhat imaginary, as in it exists. We don't actually know what happens in there, so it's kind of an imaginary space as well. So yeah, I don't know if that answers your question, but thank you. In terms of the mimicry and mimesis, I would say, I would actually probably go back to African American studies where it's common to say, you know, what's special about Black art sometimes is that it's repetition with a difference, right? There can be repetition and that can be a strategy, but there must be a difference. And that's kind of gap that you open up is where irony, is where critique, is where a re-centering of a different perspective can happen even within mimicry.
Yeah, great. Okay, we have about 6 minutes left before we close our session. And I was just wondering if David or Andre wanted to respond to some of Evelyn's, you know, answer to your questions. David or
I just ask an additional question. It's more about background information you're thinking about, you know, specifically, you know, I noticed that the director of the Walker Hill film is Han Hyung Mo, who's a pretty major director who directed Cha Yu-bin in the 1950s. It just made me wonder where you would situate these films that you're talking about in the 1960s in terms of kind of mainstream cinematic culture in South Korea and Taiwan. Are these, you know, major productions? It seems like some of them are and some maybe are not. And you know, I'm kind of like thinking again about the relationship, although, you know, you kind of explained how these are somewhat different from what we would think of as being a musical in the kind of Hollywood sense of the word, but musicals are still doing, you know, are very good productions in Hollywood in the 1960s. You mentioned West Side Story, The Sound of Music, and I'm just kind of wondering about kind of the place in kind of popular culture these films you're talking about are occupying.
Okay, right. So I guess this is a good question, because you're right, Han Yong-mo is a major director, and I would have presumed that he had many more resources and you know, a lot more production cost than any of the Taiwanese films that I showed, which were because Taiyuan are kind of low budget and sort of made very quickly and not subsidized by the government at all, because they don't approve of Taiyu. And so there is, I think, a greater degree of correctness that does have to apply there, because of how big of a fish it is in the sea of, you know, various films being made. And there were many films being made, but I think the number of production companies during this time in Korea was being kind of pruned forcibly by the government, so it could be more carefully monitored. And, you know, there are a lot of, you know, there's a few major productions and then a lot of minor productions that are sort of shopped out to the, you know, smaller companies. And this is one of the big ones, right? So you would expect that, you know, it has a particular position there. The Taiyuan, I would say a single one of them is probably not going to be as big, but as a sort of cultural phenomenon, they were much more popular and much more numerous than the Goryuan in Taiwan until the late 1960s. So in terms of their popularity, they kind of came up very quickly, but as a, you know, so they kind of disappear quickly as well. But as a group, I think that it shows something when you see so many films that are depicting this.
Yeah, I wanted to say I'm impressed and satisfied with how you responded. You anticipated everything that I had in mind, and more. And you're so right that there's this longer Japanese engagement with jazz and Americanism and things like that, that filters changes. It's not so directly linked to the post 1945. U.S. occupation or presence of bases, and I did on the colonial, the post-colonial note. You know, I did wonder if maybe Taiwanese or Korean reception of jazz pre 1945 would also have been filtered through Japan. Like, you know, so much access to, like, things that are Western, you know, comes through the empire. So I wondered if that was one thing I had in mind with the post-colonial resonance of this. And yeah, I also was thinking of Ampo and things like that, that expressing anti-Americanism in Japan was not all that difficult or radical. I think left-wing thought was also much more acceptable than in the very different environments of Taiwan and South Korea. And that, you know, that I was also one more thing I was thinking about with your written paper that maybe wasn't foregrounded today is, you know, class was really central to your to some of your arguments, and I thought those readings were superb. But it didn't sound to me like maybe a socialist, a Marxist class critique in these films, but rather this there's some class resentment and regional resentment, but also an aspirational of displacing and taking on the exclusionary classes that are associated with America. And then one more thing, I'm glad that you had brought up Okinawa in your talk, and I'm just thinking that maybe is it the difference in the lack of representations of bases in some of the films I'm thinking of, that so many of the bases in Japan are spatially peripheral to the center, put in Okinawa or Sasebo. You know, not that, you know, those presences closer to the capital region. But overall, thank you again. I'm happy to share Giants and Toys with you, or I think I have a rip somewhere, because I'm tempted to put it up on the screen. Even there's some moments that I think about it more, you'll really enjoy. And Tokyo Drifter, just for the visuals.
Professor, do you want to quickly respond, maybe 1 minute, because we're running out of time?
Sure. Right. So I'll just quickly respond to the jazz thing, which is, I think that there is especially a strong association with Inca and how it hybridized a lot of styles. It's called different things in Taiwan and in Korea in the post-war period. But in terms of jazz itself, I think this particular types of like the forms of jazz that made it through, I think would have like been there. But then you have a quick influx of, you know, new Americanist types of jazz and other music that quickly takes precedence over that. And so I would say like the Inca is like really the one that you really see the imprint of and easily can.
Okay, well, unfortunately, we're running out of time. We actually went a minute over, but it's all right. Well, before we close today, our session, let me really thank our three speakers for joining our CCS webinar today, for Dr. Su's wonderful presentation, and to Dr. Kolikowski and Dr. Haig for the lively, inspiring dialogue and comments. To our audience, many thanks for your attendance, for your questions, and please remember to fill out the short survey. And last but not least, two announcements. Our next April 5 CCS webinar has been postponed to the fall semester. So our next CCS webinar will actually be in 2 weeks, April 12th, and featuring again an interdisciplinary faculty dialogue on the topic Confucianism and the Chinese model of global governance of social media by Professor Jintao Wang from the Department of Media Studies at Tsinghua University in China, who is currently a visiting researcher at the Manoa School of Communications and Information. Okay, so please join us again in 2 weeks. Thank you, everybody, and see you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Okay, I think. Hold on a minute.
Thank you.